Good evening. I'd like to take this time to thank you for joining us. This is Google Classroom for Parents, and I'd just like to start with some introductions. My name is Tennille Cranston, and I am a learning trainer, and I'm based out of the Learning Resource Center in Clinton. There are four trainers in total, and our job is to go into the schools and help teachers and students and administration with all of their software and hardware needs. So also with us on the line, I believe Christine Allen. She is a learning trainer. She has joined us, and Jennifer Cox is the other one. And we also have Sandy Kunkel with us. Sandy, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yes, thanks. Hi everyone, I'm Sandy Kunkel. So I'm the Technology-Enabled Learning Coordinator based in Clinton as well. And I'd just like to thank you for joining us. I'm gonna take this time to talk a little bit about the platform that we're using before I pass it over to Tennille to get into the Google Classroom piece. So this platform is Microsoft Teams. So we use this for all of our virtual conferencing needs across the district. So I have for now muted all of you so that we don't get any background noise or feedback. If you would like to ask a question, you can do so two ways. One, if you hover your mouse over the screen, you'll see a toolbar that comes up with a microphone. You can unmute yourself and ask your question. Or in that same toolbar, there is a speech bubble. If you click on that, that's the chat. You can type your question into the chat, and we'll be moderating that as well throughout this. So you can ask your questions during or at the end. Hopefully we address everything that you want to get out of this session. And if we're not able to, we can follow up with you after. So we'll provide our contact information for you. This PowerPoint and video will be posted probably tomorrow on our board's website. I'll work with our communications department to get that up and running for them so that you can find that there as well if you want to reference it later. So thank you, and over to Tennille.
Thanks, Sandy. As I mentioned, my name is Tennille, and what I'm going to do tonight is just take you through a little tutorial of what Google Classroom is all about. If you've got students with you, that is a great opportunity for them to join us, and maybe they can see something that kind of reminds them, oh, right, that's the step that I forgot. Some teachers were already using this before our school closures. Some teachers, this is very new to them. Each teacher can set up their Google Classroom and many different ways. It's all the same platform, but the structure of how they post things might be a little different. So I've tried to cover most of the topics, but like Sandy said, if we don't get to a specific issue that you're having, please reach out to us. We will be following up and we will get those answers to you. I'm going to go into presentation mode, so it takes up my whole screen. But I will be exiting, this is Google Slides that I've done this in. I will be exiting it and going into my Google Mail and perhaps a document and my own Google Classroom. I don't want to take you through 31 slides. These slides are here for you for tomorrow or next week when you run into a roadblock and you need to go back to this for reference. So this is our agenda. We're going to talk about logging into Chrome. Some people don't use Google Chrome as their browser. If you're using Safari or Firefox, no problem. You can still access your child's Google Classroom. We're going to look at how to navigate Google Classroom and log in. We're going to navigate it itself. We're going to look at the three topics: stream, classwork, and people. We're going to show you how to submit work in Google Classroom. We're going to talk about parent email, and then the last thing we're going to talk about is the IT help desk for individual schools. If you are referring back to the slideshow, These teal-colored words are actually links to those slides. So you don't have to scroll down to slide 3 or slide 29. You can just click on that link and it will take you there. So logging into Chrome. Like I said, it doesn't matter what your internet browser is, whether you're using Explorer or Safari on a Mac. Some families prefer Firefox. You can still access all of your Google for Education applications that are available to your student. What we do is we call this G Suite for Education. So it's not just Google Classroom, it's a whole bundle of things, and I will show you in future slides what that bundle is. So if we go to our internet browser, in the search bar, we're going to type google.com and it'll take you to the Google browser. This is the symbol for Chrome or Google browser. It might ask you to sign in. There might be a blue sign in the top right hand corner. Click it, see what happens. We have a saying in the tech department, just press buttons. Do not fear this technology. You will find your way. There's nothing that you can really do to hurt it. There's always a solution, and we're here to help you with that solution. So here's Google. This is what I did. I put google.com, and this is what came up at the top of my screen. And I'm actually going to go to my Google browser. So there's Google. So I've left my slideshow. There's google.com. And there's that sign in that I was telling you about. So if you click on this, you can see that it automatically switched for me. It knew that I'm Tennille Cranston and I am the user of this account. So what usually happens is you do get a login screen. And this is your login screen. So it's going to ask you for your student's email address. Now, each of our students within Avon Maitland District School Board have an email, and it's a Gmail. So it's the first four letters of the student's first name, and it's the first four letters of the student's last name. It's then followed by the three digits of their Ontario education number. Your student may know this because they've used it to log into Chromebooks or apps on an iPad. Some of our younger students may not know it, and that's okay. If you don't know it, simply contact the school IT help desk, which is on slide 29, and those are being answered by our technical resource assistants assigned to each school, and they will be able to get that information for you. So for example, my name is Tennille Cranston, so the first four letters of my first name would be T-E-N-I. The first four letters of my last name would be C-R-A-N. And if I had an O-E-N, I used 123. Our domain is the @ed.amdsb.ca. And you can see that over here on this box. So that's the sign in you should get. You're going to enter an email that looks something similar to what I have, and then you're going to press this big blue next button. So then it's going to want a password. Each student in the board has a unique password. And once again, if you don't know your student's password or your student can't remember it, please contact the school and they will be able to give you that information. So from there, you're going to hit the big blue next. When you set this up for the first time, there might be some permissions. So Google works as a package. So there'll be a welcome message. Go ahead and please read it. And then at the bottom, you're going to click the allow button. Once again, it's usually blue. You may have to scroll down to find that allow button. But what it usually asks you is things like, can we access your Google Drive? And I'm going to explain what all of those things are. So you need to allow Google Drive and Gmail and Google Classroom to all talk to each other. So that's what those allow buttons are. Google has been vetted by the Avon-Maitland District School Board Tech Steering Committee and senior staff, and has been decided that it's a safe option for our students to use. So if you're not used to using Google, I've done a little side-by-side comparison. So you heard me talk about Google Docs. That's the equivalent, if you're a Microsoft user, to Word. I did this presentation in Google Slides, so Microsoft's option is Presentations. We use Gmail, which is Google Mail, throughout our district, so all staff and students have a Gmail account. Microsoft uses Outlook. You might use TNT21 or hearintel.ca, Rogers, Hotmail. There's lots and lots of email domains. Google has something called Sheets, which is spreadsheets. Some students might use it in the senior levels. If you're a Microsoft user, that would be Excel. And Google has something that is called Google Drive. In Microsoft, it's called OneDrive, but those are both cloud-based storage systems. So I like to think of it as my file folders and my filing cabinet that I have in my house. In my filing cabinet, there are separate files, and in those file folders, I put my papers and my important information. That's essentially what's in a student's Google Drive. So I'm just going to mention something about Google for Education. Anytime your student uses the Google Docs, the Google Slides, or Google Sheets, it is automatically saved in their Google Drive. And I think that's why we use this, because it is so handy for our students. We don't have to go and look for the save button or, you know, exit out and then go, oh, did I save that? And then your work is gone. It instantaneously, with every new keystroke that you do, it will save your information. So when the student opens a document from their teacher in this Google Classroom, it is automatically saved in their Google Drive. Google Drive is smart enough to associate that your student has a Google Classroom account, so it creates a folder for you. So this little snapshot down here, where it says Miss Doucette's practice class, that's actually from my Google Classroom that I've created. I added myself as a student, and this is the folder that it put within my Google Drive. There's the icon up there. And if I need to find something for my class, I can go into Drive, find that folder, and I can find all of my assignments there. So before I get too much into Google Classroom, I'm going to go back to Google, because I want to show you something very, very important. And this is in a previous slide, so I kind of skipped through it. But we were talking about signing in, and I talked about your students' first four and last four in their OEN. When they are signed in, over here, that blue button that said sign in has now changed. So it should either be the first initial of your student, or some students have already changed their profile. So it might be a picture of them, or it might be a origami cat. Google gives you some options that the students can use. And I know that students in the classroom that use these tools on a daily basis with their teacher love to organize their drive, and they like to put different pictures in, and they may have a different icon. Mine's just a purple circle. If you have more than one student in your house that logs onto Google, it's not important for your student to log out and log in each time. You can actually come down here and add another account. So you can have multiple people signed in to Google from various accounts. So as you can see, I've got my Board of Education account. I've got my Learning Trainer. So that's what I set up when I am trying to test something. And then I have my personal email attached too. So you could add two students, five students, mom and dad can be on it, any Google user, you can have, it's limitless. And then if you want to switch from one student to the next, you just simply toggle on the next name, you sign in, and their Google will come up. Something else I want to draw your attention to is there's two places that you'll see my T. So you'll see my name up here and you'll see my name down here. If I'm in Safari, which I can pull up, I'm not sure if it'll, no, it won't. So Safari doesn't have the second sign in. It is only in Chrome. So we've got a learning trainer named Sue Faber, and she calls this the mothership. So this is kind of like the Chrome browser. And when you sign into your Chrome browser, what happens is you get all of your child's extensions come up. And you're going, what? What's an extension? What's an app? And these are all listed in the slide deck. So I'm going to talk about it, but if you're still confused, you can go back and you can look at it. An app or an extension. So an extension helps your experience in Chrome. So these are all of my extensions. These three right here, many of our students use. So if you have a student that uses Google Read and Write for their schoolwork, you're going to need to sign them into this Google account. Because if you don't, they're not going to get the option of opening up their documents and using Google Read and Write. If you don't have that option and you only have this one, that is fine. That's what you're going to find in Safari. But as soon as you log into this, this gives you access to all of the apps, which are little bundles of software within our G Suite that are your students. So this is my Google Drive. So if my colleague Christine Allen was signed into her Google account, it would be her Google Drive, and she's going to get all of the files that she's created in her Drive. I'm going to get all the files that I've created in my Drive. So these are all customized to me. And as you can see, there are a lot. Now, all of our students don't use all of these apps. Some of them use different apps for different purposes. The younger grades, it looks different for them versus the senior grades. So if you are not a native Google user and you're just going to be using it for Google Classroom, maybe your Gmail, your Docs, and your Drive, you can actually customize this area. So you might find Google Classroom is way at the bottom. So I'm just going to take it to the bottom. So if you don't see it on the first page, it might be on the second page. So if I want it closer to the top so that my student can log in and see it easily and help them find their information, what you do is you left click it and you can drag it up to the top. Okay, so you can rearrange those. So these are the ones that I use the most. So there's Google Classroom, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. So Google Classroom is a learning management system. It's called an LMS. So a classroom is, your classroom teacher may use this learning management system to send and receive work to their students in a paperless fashion. So when we went to school, you know, we had textbooks and pen and paper, and we'd have photocopied sheets that the teachers would give us, and we'd work on those worksheets and hand them in. In today's technologically advanced classrooms, what the teacher does is they goes to the photocopier, they photocopy it, and then email it to each of their students. Their students can open that document, do their work, and then email it back to the teacher so that it can be marked. There's no paper that's passed. It's all done electronically. So teachers can use this Google Classroom platform to make announcements. They can have discussions. They can collect classwork, hold quizzes, or just use it to check in with their students. And with COVID-19, some of our primary students, grade kindergarten and grade one maybe, their teachers might just be using them just to check in. You know, how's it going? They'll post something in the stream and we'll talk about that. Don't worry. And all they're asking you to do is write a quick comment or upload a picture. And I'm going to show you how to do that. If you have a student that's maybe in grade 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8, maybe their classroom teacher already used this, so they will be getting more regular assignments. And I'm going to show you how to open those assignments, find them, and help your student with those. Okay. The nice thing about Google Classroom is it allows for parents to receive a daily or weekly email notification with outstanding work and upcoming projects. Slide 27 tells you how to sign up for that. The teacher has a part in it. You'll receive an email. I will show you how all of that works. Okay. So finding Google Classroom. So there's a couple ways you can do it. You can go up to your browser, which is up here, and just type in google.classroom. And it takes you to Google Classroom. It's this first search. If you're signed in though, I can go to my app selector and I can come down here to the icon and click Google Classroom. So as you can see, I am in the Google Classroom program, and these are called tiles. So each teacher may create a tile. This is where it can be set up differently depending on what school you're at or what level your student is in. If you've got a high school student, you may find that they've got 4 tiles. You've got one tile for period 1, period 2, period 3, and period 4. If you're in the elementary, you might find that there's just 1. But then the rotary teachers, so phys ed and math and French, add to that one teacher's classroom. Or you might find that your student has multiple classrooms. So the French teacher might have a classroom, the gym teacher might have a classroom, the music teacher in the homeroom. So you're really going to have to go in and you're going to have to look and you're going to have to see how it's set up. If you have any problem with that, reach out to the help desk at your school. If they can't help you, they'll send you on to us and we will get the answers for you. So there's a couple of ways of joining your class. So you can join through the tile, and that's what these are called. So as you can see, Miss Doucette's practice class is the one that I've got set up for this. So I can simply click on the tile. You'll see that it's underlined and it'll take me into the classroom. Some teachers might send you a code. So if you have a code and you don't see the tile, you're going to come over to this plus, create or join a class. And don't worry, this is in the slide deck, so you don't have to take notes. But if I click on it and I hit join class, this is where I'm going to type that code that is specific to the classroom that the teacher has created. I'm going to use the tile. I'm going to click on it and I'm into the Google Classroom for Miss Doucette. By the way, I'm also Miss Doucette. Kind of confusing, I know. Same person. So I've created this class for this purpose. As you can see, I've posted some things. I've been using this for the last couple of weeks to help our teachers understand what Google Classroom can do for them. And now I am so happy to be able to show parents the technology that their students are using or can use. So now that we're into the class, we're just going to kind of dissect it. So the first thing we're going to talk about is this toolbar up here. So we've got the stream, we've got classwork, and we've got people. These are all tabs. You can see as I hover over them, they kind of change color. So stream shows all the posts in chronological order. Newest post at the top, so you'll see May 1st. Older posts at the bottom, there's April 16th. So it's kind of like your feed on Facebook. Everything that's posted in Google Classroom, you're going to see it here. The second tab is classwork. So when a teacher assigns a quiz or an assignment, this is where you can find it. Now there's a couple ways to set this up, and I will discuss that. But before I do, I'm just going to flip to people. So people is where you will see your teacher. And if you have to get a hold of your teacher, if you come all the way over there, you can click on the envelope and it will open your student's Gmail account. And you can actually send an email to the classroom teacher doing it this way without having to find Gmail in the app selector and sending it that way. So just a neat quick little link that's there. Close that. I'm going to go back to classwork because this is where I think you're going to find most of your information between stream and classwork. So what teachers can do is teachers can create topics. So you'll see here down the side, history, geography, math, social studies, bellwork, and language. I have created those topics. Within those topics, so if I click history, it's going to jump me down to the history section, and you're going to see anything that your teacher has assigned, if they've set up the topics, and it's kind of like a category heading. So under history, there's an assignment on World War I. If I go down to math, there's a quiz on money. If I want to see all the topics, I hit all the topics and I can just scroll down and I'm going to see everything that has been assigned. So if I hit view your work, this is kind of a synopsis and I can see what's been assigned. As a student, I can see what has been returned with a grade because teachers can mark through this platform and what is missing. So these are important things to keep an eye on. So these are the titles of any of the assignments that my teacher has sent. Due date, you'll see that I have not put due dates for a lot of these, but some of them I have. So this assignment, long and short A, was due on May 8th, and as you can see, I've turned it in. So this is a great way to see what your student has done and hasn't done. So on April the 3rd, my teacher posed the question, what are your plans for the weekend? And you'll see that it says missing. So I did not answer this. And it's highlighted in red, so it's a really quick way of seeing what you've missed. The assigned is bolded. Once you have turned it in, it becomes grayed out. So that's also a really handy feature for students and parents alike. Okay, just going to scroll to the top. I'm going to hit the back button. So I'm in that classwork tab. Along the top, you'll see the view your work, which is where I was. This is Google Meet, which is an online, it's very similar to the Teams that we're doing right now. It's a teleconferencing platform. Some teachers are using it, some are not. There's a link to a calendar. This Google Calendar is specific just to Miss Doucette's practice class. So Miss Kunkel's English class, anything that she posts, I'm not gonna see because it's a different class. And then remember how I said that Google Classroom liked to be linked to your Google Drive and your Gmail. Well, this is a quick link that would take me to my Google Drive and I would be able to find my assignments in that drive also. When teachers post an assignment, usually what they do is they select a feature called Make a Copy for Each Student. So if there's 32 students in the class, your student is one of those, the teacher will create a copy for everybody, and it will come up as, in my case, tennille.cranston, and then it would say flower pollination. So it's a great way to organize on the teacher's side. The students don't notice it so much. They don't realize that their classmates have the same thing. It's built into the system, and it's a great way for organization for our students. Okay. So I'm going to go back to the stream, because some people are going to find that they're only getting things in stream. So this is where you're seeing what the assignments are and when they're due. So I can click on this. And this is something that I did with a teacher in Clinton, Ms. Wise. So I posted it. You can see that it's worth marks. And what I want to draw your attention to is these comment boxes. So if I write a comment here, it is going to the whole class. And that's a great way to celebrate a birthday, or if we're working on a group project, or if I'm not quite sure what my peers are thinking and we are allowed to communicate with each other, this is a great way of doing this. It becomes a thread that everybody can see. If I'm having problems with something and I want to talk just to my teacher, I can come over here to add private comments. And you can send your comments just to the teacher. If I'm over here, I'm going to send my comments. To the whole class. So I want to make sure that I'm doing the right thing. What you're also going to see, this is in stream, but it looks very similar when you're on classwork, is over here. So this is the assignment. Remember I said it was called Jamboard. As you can see here, there's a Google Jamboard. There's my name, because when the teacher sent this out, they made make a copy for all. And this is a link to what my teacher wants me to do. So if I click on it, it's going to open up what we call a Jamboard. And this is just like, it's a whiteboard essentially. So it's one of the products that's in the Google suite. So my teacher has asked, what is your favorite food? So I responded, I love Chinese food. Unfortunately, all the buffets are closed right now, so it's just takeout only, but that's okay. So I add the content that I want to add, and then I can just exit out of this tab. Now, remember I said every time you open something in Google, whether it's a Google Doc, a Google Jamboard, a Google Slide, it automatically saves for you. So I don't have to find the save button. I can do my work. Once my work is done, I just close out. Remember, it's saved in my Google Drive. It's running behind in the background. And then this changed to unsubmit. So I've sent it to my teacher. However, I can unsubmit it. So if I decide that I want to make changes to it, and as long as it's before the due date, which I don't think there's a due date on this one, I can hit unsubmit. Sometimes that's not an option. Once you've turned it in, it's turned in and you can't go back and look at it again. But this is a great thing for students that, you know, they're just not quite sure what they want to write today. They're not feeling it. They're not in the mood. You know, mom's pushed 3 hours of homework on me already. But maybe tomorrow morning I wake up and I'm like, that Jamboard that I was working on for Miss Wise, I'd really like to add this information. They can go in, they can unsubmit it. There it is. I can go back in. I can do any changes I want, and then I can turn it in again. When I hit turn it in, it's going to ask me, do I want to turn it in? Absolutely. So there you go. You can see right here that I've turned it in. So there's no attaching extra information. There's no going to my Google Drive and finding it. They are connected because we've allowed those permissions, and this is a really simple way. Now, this screenshot is in the slide deck, so if you decide that you need a little bit of help somewhere in the future, no problem. you can go back and look at it. So I'm gonna discard. I'm going back to my main page. So here in my stream, if I had some really exciting news that I wanted to share with my classmates, I could post it right here. So guess what? My flowers are finally blooming today. I know, it's so exciting. But if I wanted to add a picture of the flowers in my garden that are blooming or whatever I've been working on, I can hit this add button down here. So I can add from Google Drive. So if I've taken a picture, this is where parents have to remember that if you're just using your phone, you might have to go to the Google Play Store or the Apple iTunes Store and download Google Drive. The challenge for parents is trying to get that picture off of my phone or off of my tablet and into that drive. So usually wherever you find three dots, that's kind of the more feature. If you click on that, Google Drive might come up and you can send it that way. If I've done a YouTube video and I have a link, I can add the link. If I've done something on my Windows device and it's saved, or my MacBook and it's saved to my desktop, I can add it as a file. There's YouTube. However I decide that I'm going to add it, once it's added, I just hit post. And now you can see it's in my stream. And my classmates can comment on it. So if you're in your student's stream and you see this, you can go to class comment and you can add things. Okay, so classwork we've kind of talked about. I'm just going through my slide deck to make sure that we've covered them. I just want to go back and I want to show you some of the ways that teachers can post assignments. So you'll see these little icons. This is an assignment, so that means that there might be something attached to it. This is material. Actually, if I go to this, I know that there's something attached to it. And if this is a link to the internet and I just click on it, and what it's going to do is it's going to open that new tab. So Classroom is still here. It's still working in the background, but now I can go in and I can do what the teacher has assigned from the internet for me to do. So lots of teachers might be adding Scholastic book work or check out this YouTube video. It is as simple as click on it and it'll open in another tab. When I'm done doing my flower pollination video, I just click it off. Okay, so I've closed that tab and I'm back in my classroom. If I scroll down here, Capital Cities is a Google form. So if I click on it, once again, you can see it's taking me out of classroom and it's opening up a Google form. When I answer something like this as a student, I'm just gonna randomly click and I hit submit, you can see that my responses are submitted and my assignment is marked as done. That's all it is. It's submitted to the teacher. The teacher's going to receive an email that Tennille.Cranston has done it. And I just click the X and get out. So it's really user-friendly. It's just don't be scared to get in there and try it. Okay. So you're going to find that you're going to have to mark things as done sometimes. So such as a Google quiz, when you go back into it, you might see that you've done it. Or if you know that if you've done it, you can mark it as done. So if your student is working in a Google Doc, I'm just going to open a new tab. And there's Google Doc. Google Docs is just a blank piece of paper that our students can write on. So when they open it up, I just want to show you the saving feature. You can see up here it says saving. So all changes are saved in Drive. So it will tell me that on this document, the last edit was made seconds ago. So if your student is working on a writing assignment and they might work on it over 3 or 4 days, that's okay. It is going to save what you do on Monday. You just open it back up. You can start writing from where you are on Tuesday. And on Wednesday, once again, you just relaunch this document and continue adding to it. It is saved in their Drive, so they just have to find it. One of the things that really our students tend to miss is up here, titling that document. So if you're a guardian or a parent sitting with a student and you can just encourage them, make sure that it is a title that it is meaningful so that they can find it again in their Google Drive, it's going to save you a lot of gray hairs. So it's something that we're constantly reminding our students to do because they do tend to forget it. But I just wanted to quickly show you how that works. So I'm going to call it a file, and you'll see that it's in my Google Drive. Okay. When I'm done, there's no saving. I just exit, and then I can work on it. So you might find a link within the Google Drive that is to a document that your students will need to complete, add, or type on as a reflection piece. So that's how that works. It's a little different if your student is using PDFs, using Text Help PDF Reader. So I'm going to slip back to the presentation, and I'm going to slide down to slide 25. So if your student uses Google Read and Write, you can use it within Google Classroom, so that's great. Google Read and Write is a screen reader, and it'll help read what is on the assignment or on the screen. If you need some help with PDF Text Help Reader, reach out to the school. They'll put you in contact with somebody that can kind of give you a run through. And if you have any questions, by all means, you ask. We're always here to help. So as you can see, this screenshot actually came out of my Google Classroom. So I had a PDF, and you can see that it's unsubmitted. So when I clicked on the PDF, it asked me how I wanted to open it. And I wanted to open it with Google Read and Write for Chrome. If your student uses Google Read and Write, they'll know to look for the purple puzzle piece. When they open that document, at the very top right-hand corner is a student icon. So if they click on that, they can then choose the class. There's a drop-down menu, because remember, they might have multiple teachers. They can find the assignment they're working on. This one was called Long and Short A. And then they hit the blue Go button. The next pop-up window is over here. It's going to say Attach. So what it's going to do is it's going to attach a copy of the file that is in their Google Drive and send it to their teacher. So then you select Turn It In, and off it goes. So there's no need to share a link, send an email. This learning management system of Google Classroom does all of those things for you with a click of a button. And like I said, just click buttons. If you turn it in and it's not done, the teacher will notify you and will help guide you through those steps. One of the really neat things about Google Classroom is you as a parent can be added to get classroom summaries. So if we look at this line, this is a screenshot right from my Gmail. Learning Trainer is actually the teacher. Janelle.Cranston, I'm the student. And this was sent to my personal, my Gmail email address. So I got notification Get Google Classroom Email Summaries for the Student. So you're going to get an invitation from the teacher and you're going to hit accept. And actually, if I bop to my email, I have it right there for you. So this is the screen you're going to get. The teacher has invited you as a guardian in Google Classroom. So this is your student's name will appear here, and you have the option of accepting, or if you're not the guardian, don't accept. So if I hit accept, it's going to ask me, for me, which account, there's that sign in box for Google. You probably won't have that if you're not a Google user or if you're already logged into your computer. I had signed out of everything, but you're going to want to hit accept. And this is the screen that's going to pop up. So there's your student's name, and you can say how you want them to come. You have the options of daily, weekly, or no summaries at all. If you chose no summaries, guess what? You're not going to know what is due or what is late or what's coming up next week. If you choose daily, you are going to get a record of what has been happening that day, what was due that day, what was missed, and I believe what's coming up in the future. Or if you hit weekly, let me go back to daily for a second. Daily is Monday to Friday, so Saturday and Sunday, you're not going to get an email. If you choose weekly, you are going to get that email Friday afternoon in your inbox, and you're going to see what has been done or has not been done in real time for the last week. So that's also a great way to go, you know, you had an English project due on Thursday and you didn't do it. Guess what you're doing this weekend? You can also choose time zone. So mine's on Detroit. If I was in the Galapagos, I guess I could get my students' summaries sent at the appropriate time. So there's nothing to save on this page. You just do your selection of how you want them. I've chosen daily, and then you X out of it. That's it. So that's the email for parents, which is a nice feature. So I'm going to go back. We'll go back here. I'm just keeping an eye on the time because I want to leave time for questions. As I mentioned earlier, if you've got any problems with the technology that's been handed out or the technology that your student has brought home from the school, or if you've got any problems with Google Classroom or how Gmail works, or Google Docs, feel free to reach out to the school. Each school has a help desk. Now, each of these teal lines are the actual, they are live. So if I wanted to send, let me pick one I know at least. If I wanted to send my friend Linda Ray at Goderich Public School, she's the TRA. If I wanted to send a question, I can just click on that link. It's going to open up in whatever email platform you use. It's going to put the help desk right there, and you can put your subject in. Okay. When you're trying to do this, it's great if you can put Google Classroom or uploading files in Google Classroom. Try to make it as specific as you can. I understand that sometimes if you don't come from a tech background, you don't know what questions to ask, and that is fine. Some of the password questions, the school help desk won't be able to answer, and they're just going to forward it on to us in Clinton, and we will try to get the answer back to them. So they're kind of the go-between between the parent and the school, so anything that they can answer, and if they can't, like I said, it kind of just moves up the chain to us. So that's the help desk emails. So they're all there. They're all alphabetical. There's three pages of them. It was also on Facebook. So if you want to go into the link and bookmark it so that you always have that link, that's a great option too. So that is a really quick version in 50 minutes of what Google Classroom does. I hope I've answered some of the questions. Sandy, is there any questions that have come up in the chat?
No, not yet.
Okay, so I'm just gonna flip back for 2 seconds to classwork, because I wanted to show you, I just kind of skimmed over, it's actually in language, whoops, and it's not gonna work, language. Okay, there's that PDF that I was discussing earlier. I just want to touch base on this because I think this is probably going to be a sticking point for most parents. So this is that little icon in the PDF that I was talking about. And if I click on it, there's that choose class. So I would find the teacher that I'm enrolled in. And then I can choose my assignment.
Tanil, we're not seeing that.
Oh, you're right. You won't. My apologies. It's in the slide deck. So if you find that you're doing it with your student and it's just not working, refer to the slide deck. The screenshots are exactly the same as the screenshots that you would follow. So I'm going to open another tab. I'm going to go up to the app selector. And I just want to take you into Google Drive for a second. Google Drive can be very overwhelming for our students, but it's a great organizational piece. And I just want to show parents what it looks like, because if you don't use Google, you don't have one. And it's really, really an amazing tool. So up here at the top are the documents that I use quite regularly. So what you see is there's the slideshow that I'm working on. There's that Google Doc that I opened on the fly that I said it saves as I write. So if I wanted to reopen it, it's there. This is a document that I worked on today. It's actually going to go to the garbage can because it's not that important. But students can create folders. And remember I said that Google Drive creates a folder for you. So if I come down here, I should find, might be that one. You should find one that says Google Classroom. And that's where all of your students' files will be kept. If they're working on other things, they can create new ones. Right in Drive, we can create docs. So there's amazing things that you can do within Google Drive, and just sit down with your student, have them show you what they already know. And now that you've taken this session, maybe you know something that they don't. So take the opportunity, don't stress about it, and just play with the technology that's there. All right, Sandy, I think that's probably all I have. Anybody want to include anything else? Do you have anything you want to include?
No, I am good. You did a great job. If there are any questions, you could unmute yourself. Again, just hover on the screen and click that microphone button. That'll unmute you. Oh, we do have a question. Could you just quickly show again where you click to add the parent email subscription?
Okay, so what has to happen is the teacher, I'm going to open a new tab. Oops, I spelled that wrong. So many passwords. So as the process goes, the teacher also has a Google Classroom because they've set it up. This is what it looks like from their end. So when they go to people, all of their students will be listed here. The teacher actually has to add invite guardians. So they're going to click invite guardian. They're going to type the email that you've provided to the teacher right there. They're going to hit invite. I doubt it'll let me do it twice. No. So once that occurs, you will get a little invitation in your personal Google or your personal email, whatever that might be. And if I go here, so this is what it's going to look like. Get Google Classroom email summaries for, and then your student name will be there. You click on it. You're going to hit accept. So there's no way that you yourself can do it. It has to be set up through the teacher.